Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you how you can animate some particles using armatures and also use a volumetric system. So you can see here I've got a set of sort of wriggly particles. They're actually emitting light. You can just about see it reflecting off the surface. And in close-ups, you can see you get some interesting effects when they intersect. And I'm going to show you how they're animated as well, because they're not simply going through the same motions over and over again, although their motion is limited. They're actually following a relatively random path. The reason that they all seem to be doing it together is because there are children, so the children of the primary particle are following along. But it'll all become clear as we go through. So to begin with, we need to create our particles. We need to make sure that we have our particles in the same layer, that's these down here, as the main scene, otherwise the animation of the particles won't work. So to begin with, I'm just going to add a cylinder. Scale that, Shift Z on everything except for the Z axis. Really doesn't matter too much about the modeling here because I'm really just showing you the techniques. And now with Control R, I'm adding some loop cuts. So you can see without those, the armature is not going to work very well. I've covered that in some of my other videos. So we've got a simple cylinder and some loop cuts. If you want to, you can add a subdivision surface. Obviously, you can have whatever shape you want. I'm just going to keep it very simple like that at the moment, because we don't want too many vertices in the scene, and we're obviously going to create lots of copies of this, but I will set it to smooth shading, not that it matters that much. The reason it doesn't matter that much is because we're not really going to have a surface on this particular version, although you may do something different. So let's put a simple material on it. Pull down a new window and go to the node editor. Come over to materials and just say new, and you can see immediately we get the basic material appear there. Press N to get rid of that on the right hand side if you don't want it. So at the moment it's a diffuse material, which means it'll be on the surface. I'm going to use an emission material as part of the volumetric render, so I don't need a surface material. You can have both, and if you set the surface to relatively translucent or transparent, you can get some interesting effect. Because I'm going to use the volumetric input, I need to be in CPU compute. If, like me, you've got an NVIDIA graphics card with CUDA, you may be using GPU compute because obviously it speeds up rendering. But currently, GPU compute does not support volumetric rendering. So now we can add a shader. There are three shaders that work with volumetrics. And that's volume scatter, volume absorption, and emission. So I'm going to use emission in this case and just connect it to the volume input. So if we just select here and say border, and look through our camera, that will mean it won't render anything that's outside of the camera view while we're looking through the camera, and we'll go to rendered view. It does render more when, obviously, when you're not looking through the camera. You can't really see that you can see through this, but you can see there it's an emission object. Now, to make it a little bit more interesting than that, what I did was I affected the emission strength by a procedural texture. So if we now add a Voronoi texture and we take the factor of that into strength, and now render it. Now you should be able to see that there's actually a three-dimensional structure in there, because procedural textures are three-dimensional, they're not just 2D surfaces. I'm also going to add now a color ramp and drop that in there so that I can have some elements of it basically black, which means transparent for all intents and purposes. Now what I also need to do is either unwrap this or use a texture coordinate that doesn't require unwrapping, such as generated. And then I can put a mapping node in there so that I can play around with how that maps. So for example, let's try altering the Z, go the other way, and there we go. You can see we've now got a less stretched structure, and we might want to go for an even smaller scale than that. And there's another reason for doing this, and that is because this allows us to animate that texture. So you can see that's actually a three-dimensional texture inside this object. And if I add a simple plane now, you can now see there's a little bit of light leaking onto the plane, and that's coming from this object. And if I duplicate it and perhaps rotate it, there's a piece behind. You may just be able to make out that you can actually see one through the other. And we can, obviously, we don't have to have white, we can have whatever color we want. And we can also add a math node in here, which can either be an add node, but that will give it a sort of basic minimum illumination, or we can make it a multiply node, which still allows for zero, but means that we can make the high values much higher. So if we zoom in here, you can see the one behind shining through the one in front. So the only thing we need to do now with that shape I'm doing it now before I make any more to save me having to repeat it, is we want to animate that texture. So we can do that very easily with this mapping node. We could do it with scale. We can animate any of these elements in here. But if we go to the beginning of the timeline and we press I across location, we then go to the end of the timeline and perhaps set X to 5. You can see all of the noise pattern moved a little bit there. Maybe we'll set Y to -5 and press I there. Now, as we go through the timeline, you can see the pattern is moving. And you could also adjust scale and rotation and so on just as easily. Now, at the moment, it will start slow, speed up, and then slow down again. So if we quickly swap to the graph editor, there are our parameters varying, and go to key, they're already selected, and change the interpolation mode to linear. And now they'll change at the same speed throughout the scene. So I'll just give that one a yellow colour in the viewport, and then in a minute I'm going to create some more and I'll give them a slightly different colour. But the next thing to do is how to animate this. So I'm just going to move that window up there for now. And what we need to do is add an armature. Very simple one. So we go into armature and we add a single bone. Before I do anything with the bone, I'm going to come over to the object properties of the bone, go to display and set it to X-ray for the time being. Make sure I'm looking from the left and the right that it is in the center of the object, which it basically is, or very near it. It doesn't have to be perfect for this application. Go into edit mode and take the top of the bone to the top of the object. Something I forgot to do, so I'm just going to hide that bone for a minute, is I need to set the origin of this object down here. I can do that by putting the cursor down there first, or I can just go into edit mode, move up till that little yellow dot is right at the bottom, just above the bottom really, come out of edit mode and pull it back down to the red line, which is the origin. So Alt H to bring my bone back. Now with one bone, I'm not going to get a lot of movement. So if I go into edit mode with the bone selected, A to select both ends of the bone, W to bring the specials menu up and say subdivide, and I'm going to subdivide twice, which gives me three bones. So that's 3 points at which it can bend. If we go into pose mode, we can now select a bone and move that. Or this one, pressing R to rotate them, and you can see the one above moves with it. And R to move this one, which moves all of them, because that's the base bone. But we now need to link the object to this. So we select the object, select the bone, Control P, and say armature with automatic weights. Now select the bone, go to pose mode, and move it. And you can see it's now moving the object in a very crude way, as you can see. And if I select my object and do Control 1, what I've now done is added some vertices. I'm just adding an extra loop cut at the top and bottom just to keep the shape. So now when I rotate, I've got a few more vertices for the deformations to work on. We've now got an armature which will deform our object. So now we just need the armature to move with the object. Now I'm just going to duplicate this armature and object set and move them over to one side, just slightly out of view of the camera. I'm also going to rotate Y90 for each of the objects, because typically that's what you're going to need when you put the particles into the scene, because it's just the way particle systems seem to work, and that will make them then stand upright, making sure I'm selecting the bone because that's the parent. So I've got my three objects there. I'm going to give them a little bit of space between each other, because they're going to start wriggling around shortly. Go to the top one, press the little 3, because that material is used in 3 places. I'm going to change the viewport colour, and I'm going to change the emission colour. And do it for this one as well. Press the little 2. We'll make this one have a viewport colour of red, and a render colour of red. So we've got 3 different colours now. You can see in pose mode, because of the way I copied them, the bone setups are already there, and they're already affecting the right object. So we now just need to add some movement into these objects. So I'm going to need the graph editor up here, and I'm in pose mode. But before I go any further, one of the things that is interesting is at the moment, if I press G in pose mode here, I can rotate this top particle around by moving my mouse around, and I'm not using R for rotate, just G, but I can't move the whole thing around. However, if I click here and add an inverse kinematics bone constraint, and then try to move this, you can see it's now moving the whole thing around. Now, if I wanted to limit that, I could just say one there, or two. You can now see it affects one more link, or three to affect them all, or just leave it at zero, and that's infinite. So you can now see just by moving, I can move this object around. So I'm just going to go, and I should have done this before I copied it, and add that bone constraint to each of these others. And I'm adding it in pose mode to that top one. You can probably do it in edit mode as well. So that's the inverse kinematic bone constraint. It's really used to simulate arms and hands and things like that so that you can move the end bone around and the rest of it moves with it. It's a very powerful modifier. So having added that, I now need to just make this bone move around to make the whole shape move. So we're going to add an empty. And put the cursor there, add an empty, which will make a plane axis. And that's basically where we want it to go, except for there. Again, you can do this before you create all the objects. I'm going to call that green control. And now we're going to add another empty, and we're going to make this a cube, make it a little smaller, make the green control a bit smaller as well. And we'll just put the cube somewhere about here, and we'll make this green mover. We're going to parent this empty to this one. This step isn't strictly necessary, but there is a reason for doing it, because when I rotate this one will rotate, will move rather than simply rotate. So I select the first empty, select the second empty, Control P, and say Object Keep Transform. That just means keep it where it is. Now if I select this one and rotate it, you can see that one moves around a bit, as well as when I move it. So that means if I want to, I can animate rotations as well as movements to give me more variation in the movement of this object. Now I come back to this armature. Go into pose mode and select this top bone. This is the bottom, this is the top. And say target green control. See, it may be moved slightly there. Now I go up to this. And you can now see it's as though they're stuck together. And if I rotate it, that moves it as well. So any sort of movement on here causes this object to move. So I can now go to the beginning of the timeline, press I, and just say lock rot, location and rotation, keyframed. Now come up to here, the graph editor. If it's not already up, press N to bring up the properties menu on the right hand side, and select at the bottom, add modifier, and select noise. If we just play, you can see that object is moving up and down. And if you look closely, you can see we've got a little bit of movement there. If we want to though, we take this in a little bit, so there's a bit of a bend, and lock rot there. Now you can see the object is moving a little bit. Now at the moment, it's only doing that on the X location, but we can do that on more than just the X. We can do it on the Y as well. So if we select the Y axis, add a modifier, noise, and we can play around. I widen that window, you can see what we're doing. We can play around with the size of that noise. You can see it's getting bigger and smaller there. We can change the scale, which slows it down effectively, and the phase, which just moves it around. So if I go back to the X, we can strengthen that up a little bit and again slow the scale down so it's not quite so rapid. So you can now see our object's moving in quite a few axes. It's probably a bit too strong on the X now, and you can put an offset on it as well if you don't want it to go all the way that it's going. And finally, we can do the Z as well. So we'll just add modifier noise, increase the strength a little bit, increase the scale to slow it down. So now our little box there, a little empty, is moving around in all three axes. And we could add rotation as well. You can see it's going a bit too far there, so we'll turn the strength down. And essentially, I would do that for all three. I won't do that in this case. We'll just do this with this one particle. So that's animated the particle now in a random fashion. By changing the scale and the phase, you'll make sure that each axis and each object that you animate has its own independent noise. If you don't change anything, they will all have the same noise pattern, so they'll all move together, which may not be what you want. So we've got our particle there, so I'm now going to go to my plane over here. Make it a bit bigger, raise it up slightly, and subdivide it. And I'm also now going to go to fractal down here, which gives it a little bit of noise in terms of the vertical position as I subdivide it. And now Control 2 just to make that a bit smoother with a subdivision surface. and set it to smooth shading. So that's almost like a, I guess, a sandy bed underwater somewhere, which was what I was thinking of when I first did this. So now we can come over here and add a particle system. Just say new, we'll set it to hair. And at the moment the particles are all coming out the wrong way. You can either play with the normals or just turn it RY180, and there you go, they're all coming out the right way now. But what we want to do is we don't want to use actual hair particles. What we want to do is use either an object, as I'm going to use here, or you can put these all in a group by select each one of these, not the bones but the object itself. Control G, and you see there's a green line around them now, and you can see we've got a group called group. So what I would then do, come back to my plane, and under the particle system I can select group, or if I only want one particle I can select object. If I select my object, I'm just going to give it a name, and it's going to be green part so that I know what I'm selecting. Go back to my plane and I'm going to say object green part. So there you can see there's lots of them there. Click rotation and they stood up now. And I probably don't want that many at the moment, so I'm going to just say 100. And we can play with the size of them with hair length. And if I select advanced, use modifier stack, which gives me the ability to use those extra vertices that have been created by the subdivision surface. Click rotation, and then we can play around by putting random phase on it, and perhaps a little bit of randomness from the normal. So the normal is perpendicular from the surface, so where there's a hump they'll already be coming off at a slight angle. So we press play now, you can see that they're all moving in time with this green one over here. And essentially that's all there is to it. I'll put a very basic material on this plane down here, a relatively white material, or light at least. I'm going to go back to the node editor up here with my green particle selected, and we'll stop it somewhere around there. And look at that. And you can see that the particles are actually illuminating the landscape around them. And obviously we can turn this brightness up quite a bit, say 12 as a multiplier, and they're much brighter now. It's quite slow rendering because obviously I'm using CPU render here, but you can see they're illuminating the landscape around them. And of course we've also animated this 3D texture inside them. So just a little bit about the particle distribution. We can come down to here. We can put some randomness on the size of the particles. We've already put a randomness on phase, which basically is the orientation of them. And we can add children. So if we put interpolated and we just say 3 for display and render, what you can now see is there's a lot more particles on there, but as you can see, they form groups. You can make those groups clump if you wish, either one way or push away from clumps. Basically, they point, the tops point towards each other. And you can play around with the various options for children. But be aware that all of the children will move at the same time and in the same way as the parent particle. And of course, there is only one particle here. You could do 3 here, you could do 20 here. Give them all their own movement. You could put more control points. So rather than just the end like this, you could add control points that affect the middle as well. So the whole thing is wriggling more. So there's all sorts of things you can do. And I look forward to seeing your results. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. And I look forward to seeing you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.